Shakespeare's First Folio. Hello and welcome to the discourse. We are discussing William Shakespeare, the Bard. He died on 23rd April 1616, and after that, two of his colleagues, John Heminges and Henry Quandell, put their effort in collecting all of his plays and published them as one body of literature. This collection was titled Mr. William Shakespeare's Comedies, Histories, and Tragedies. All but two of Shakespeare's plays were added to it. The two missing plays were Pericles and Prince of Tyre. Also, the first folio didn't contain any of Shakespeare's poetry, his sonnets and the two narrative poems he wrote, Venus and Adonis and Rape of Lucrece. None of them was added to the first folio. First folio was published in 1623 and it contained many such Shakespeare's plays which were performed but were not published till then. All such plays which were not published till then were marked with an asterisk before their titles. Shakespeare wrote comedies, historical plays, and tragedies. For all of his historical plays and other plays demanding knowledge of historical facts, Shakespeare preferred Raphael Holinshed's Chronicles of England, Scotland, and Ireland as his primary source. For the Greek and Roman history, Shakespeare chose Thomas North's translation of Lives, which was written by Plutarch. Shakespeare continues to be the most discussed author of all times within the circle of critics. In 1904, A.C. Bradley published his research work Shakespearean Tragedy. Shakespeare continued to be tested by critics since the start. Often he faced the criticism that he always ignored the three unities of drama that are essential according to the Aristotelian theory of drama. The unities are the unity of time, the unity of place, and the unity of action. However, Samuel Jackson strongly defended Shakespeare's works against this accusation. Samuel Jackson maintained that Shakespeare always successfully maintained the unity of action in all his plays. While Jackson conceded that Shakespeare ignored unity of time and place in some of his plays, he again defended Shakespeare by claiming that more than the unity of time and place, it is important that the drama is close to real life, which is seen in all of Shakespearean's plays. Shakespeare is also known as the only writer who successfully displayed the separations of style of characters according to their class in the society. And he did so in much better manner than any other writer of the medieval period. Shakespeare's vocabulary was immense. However, he was the writer of his times, and many things that appeared normal during his time were considered objectionable in the later years. As for example, his first tragedy, Titus Andronicus, was a massive success during the Elizabethan and Jacobean era. But during the Middle Ages, this play by Shakespeare suffered huge repudiation because of the gross graphic violence involved in it. Similarly, in 1807, Thomas Bowdler and his sister Henrietta Bowdler published Family Shakespeare. It was a collection of Shakespeare's plays edited by the two, in which they expurgated the cursive words and such scenes that were too much violent. Later they were criticized and Family Shakespeare became the most burning example of negative literary censorship. The term Bowdlerize was coined to ridicule and repudiate Thomas Bowdler, and it means to omit parts of a work on moral grounds. Two Gentlemen of Verona. Now let us discuss the place of Shakespeare. Shakespeare was initially influenced by John Lyly, and his first play that he wrote and produced was Two Gentlemen of Verona. It was a comedy which was performed in 1589. The play was unique because it was the first play in which the issue of cross-dressing was depicted. A female character disguises as a male character and pretends to be the male servant of his lover in order to spy on him. Two Gentlemen of Verona also had themes of infidelity, friendship, eloping, and forced sex. The plot involved two friends, Valentine and Proteus, who live in Verona. Proteus is in love with Julia, who also loves him. Valentine decides to go to Milan and asks Proteus to be with him. Before leaving, Proteus proposes Julia and they are betrothed. They exchange rings and Proteus vows to return back as soon as possible and marry Julia. At Milan, Valentine falls in love with the daughter of the Duke of Milan, whose name is Silvia. When Proteus sees Silvia, he also gets infatuated by her and decides to have her for himself by any means. He even forgets his love for Julia and overlooks his friendship with Valentine. The Duke wants his daughter to marry a wealthy Lord Thurio. The Duke realizes that Silvia has fallen in love with Valentine, so he locks her up so that he could forcibly marry her to Thurio. Valentine decides to free Silvia and elope with him. He discusses his plan with Proteus. Proteus, being jealous of Valentine and wanting Silvia for himself, ditches Valentine and tells everything to the Duke. The Duke orders capturing of Valentine and then he outcasts him and forces him to leave Milan. Valentine, while wandering in outlands, meets a band of outlaws. He tells them a lie that he was outlawed because he killed a man in a fair fight. Considering him strong and brave, the band of outlaws chooses him their leader. Meanwhile, Julia feels something fishy and decides to visit Milan to see Proteus. However, she decides to disguise as a boy to know what's going on and why is Proteus taking so long in returning. She meets Proteus as a boy named Sebastian and asks him to make her his page boy. Proteus agrees and he sends Sebastian with a letter to Silvia to propose her. However, Silvia refuses Proteus and she shows her disgust at Proteus because he forgot his own love Julia back in Verona. Proteus tells her that Valentine is rumored to be dead and she moans, but she couldn't believe that Valentine is dead. So she decides to run away with one of her friends and find Valentine. In the outlands, Silvia is attacked and captured by the band of outlaws who decide to take her to their leader, who is Valentine. Proteus and Sebastian confront the outlaws and free Silvia before she could meet Valentine. Proteus then exhorts his love for Silvia, but she again refuses. So Proteus decides to force himself on Valentine sexually. Seeing this, Sebastian, who actually is Julia, is shocked and she falls unconscious. However, before Proteus could attempt the rape, Valentine appears and he denounces Proteus heavily. Proteus faces a change of heart and he feels extreme guilt. Also, he realizes that Sebastian is Julia, her actual love. He asks for forgiveness. At the same time, Thurio arrives to take Silvia back, but Valentine confronts him for a battle of swords. Thurio, being afraid, runs away. The Duke realizes the cowardice of Thurio and bravery and character of Valentine and agrees to let Silvia be his wife. At the end, Julia marries Proteus, Silvia marries Valentine, and both of them are again good friends. Cross-dressing of Julia as Sebastian was a cause of uproar during that time, because as per the norms of that time, there were no female actors. Men and boys were used to cross-dress and act as female characters, but in this play, a boy had to cross-dress as a girl first, and then that girl will cross-dress and disguise as a boy again in the same play. The second successful play of Shakespeare that we will discuss was The Taming of the Shrew. It was performed in 1590. It was again a comedy. It is a story of two sisters, Bianca and Catherine. Catherine is the elder sister. While the younger sister Bianca is a kind-hearted, sweet-spoken, beautiful girl, Catherine is a beautiful, proud, nagging girl who continues to show lot of tantrums. As a result, Bianca is loved by all and she has many suitors, trying to win her in marriage. However, no one is interested in marrying Catherine, despite she is being very beautiful. Their father announces that his elder daughter Catherine will be married first and only after that he will perform marriage of Bianca. The story is about how a man, Petruchio, marries Catherine and then, with his constant exhortations mixed with love, he tames Catherine to become a pliable, obedient, sweet-spoken, faithful wife. He uses various psychological torments to achieve this. At the end, Catherine herself lectures her younger sister and another newlywed girl about why every wife should be obedient to her husband. Modern critics and audience often find this play and its theme misogynistic. Another fact about this play was that an induction frame was used at the beginning in which a wealthy lord tricks a drunkard named Christopher Sly and makes him believe that the drunkard is the actual lord. Then the wealthy lord arranges a play for the entertainment of the false Lord Sly for his entertainment to distract him from his wife. Many movies have been made based on the theme of this play. The most recent one was the Hollywood movie 10 Things I Hate About You, which was released in 1999. A Bollywood movie, Isi Life Mein, that was released in 2012, contained a subplot in which a college student performs for the dramatization of the taming of the shrew for their annual function. When the female lead of the movie objects that the play is misogynistic, the male lead suggests that he will edit the play to remove the misogynistic part, and he names this edited play as Taming of the Shrew Reborn. Next was Shakespeare's history play Henry VI, Part 1 and 2, and 3rd, for which he used Raphael Holinshed's Chronicles as the primary source. His next play was Titus Andronicus, which was the first tragedy of Shakespeare. It is believed that Shakespeare collaborated with George Peele to write this drama. George Peele was a famous university wit that we have already discussed. Titus Andronicus is a revenge tragedy, and it shows the influence of Christopher Marlowe, Thomas Kidd and other university wits on Shakespeare. Titus Andronicus is considered the most violent and bloodiest drama of Shakespeare. It was performed in 1591. It is one of the Senecan tragedies that involved extreme murders and violence. We have used this term Senecan tragedies many times since we initiated our discussion on the Elizabethan era of English literature. The first being Gobbo Duck. Senecan tragedies are a genre of drama that was first popularized during the Roman era by Lucius Annaeus Seneca the Younger. He was a Roman Stoic philosopher, a statesman, and a dramatist. He often wrote tragedies with Greek subjects, and his famous plays include Hercules, Troilus, Medea, Phaeacia, Oedipus, and Agamemnon. Titus Andronicus is a fiction with no real historical events. The title hero, Titus Andronicus, is a Roman general who had been to war against the Goths for 10 long years, in which he lost two of his sons. The play depicts the aftermath of the death of Roman emperor. His two sons, Saturninus and Bassianus, struggle to be the next emperor. However, a Roman officer, Marcus Andronicus, announces that his brother Titus Andronicus is returning after winning the war against the Goths, and the public opinion is that Titus should be the next emperor of the Rome. Titus is a popular general and everyone wants him to be the emperor. He returns and brings Queen of Goths, Tamora, and her three sons, Alarbus, Chiron, and Demetrius, along with her male slave Moor Aaron, as the prisoners of war. So, Queen of Goths, Tamora, and her three sons, Alarbus, Chiron, and Demetrius, along with Aaron, are the prisoners of war. Aaron is a secret lover of Tamora, though he is her slave, but she loves him. After returning, he declares that he doesn't want to be the emperor. Titus Andronicus declares that he doesn't want to be the emperor, and rather he supports Saturninus as the next emperor. In order to avenge the deaths of his sons in the war, Titus decides to sacrifice Tamora's eldest son, Alarbus, and kills him, despite desperate pleas of Tamora. Tamora and her remaining two sons then vows to take revenge against Titus and his family. After becoming emperor, Saturninus shows his gratitude towards Titus and asks his daughter Lavinia's hand in marriage. Titus accepts, but Lavinia is in love with Bassianus, who is already betrothed to her. Bassianus refuses to give up Lavinia, and Titus's sons also support him. However, Titus scolds his sons and blames them of treachery against the emperor. In the ensuing argument, he mistakenly kills one of his sons, Mutius, in a fit of anger. Saturninus learns this and he renounces the Andronicus family, and to show his displeasure, he rather marries Thamora, the queen of Goths. This gives her the chance to plot her revenge against Titus. First, she asks Saturninus to forgive Titus and his family, and then she supports the marriage of Bassianus and Lavinia. On the other hand, Aaron instigates Thamora's two sons to kill Bassianus in order to rape Lavinia. They kill Bassianus, Chiron and Demetrius kill Bassianus, and then the three rape Lavinia brutally. After that, they cut her tongue and both of her hands so that she may never reveal what happened to her and who killed Bassianus. Aaron forges a letter blaming the sons of Titus for the murder of Bassianus. Though he along with Demetrius and Chiron killed Bassianus himself, but he forges a letter and blames sons of Titus for the murder of Bassianus. Distraught with the murder of his brother, Saturninus orders imprisonment and death of sons of Titus Martius and Quintus. So sons of Titus named Martius and Quintus were killed. Marcus Andronicus finds Lavinia in the outlands in extremely dilapidated condition with her tongue and hands mutilated. He brings her to his brother and her father Titus. Titus suffers extreme grief and Lavinia couldn't even share her pain. She can't speak and cannot write anything. Aaron then visits Titus and falsely tells him that Saturninus is ready to pardon him and his family if any one of them, Titus, or his only living son Lucius or his brother Marcus cut their one hand and send it to Saturninus. Titus decides to cut his own left hand. However, Saturninus returns his hand with the mutilated heads of his two sons Quintus and Martius. Titus then tells Lucius to flee away and make an army with the help of his former enemies Goths to avenge the death of his brothers. Meanwhile, Lavinia succeeds in revealing the names of her rapists and murderers of her husband with the help of a stick that she picks with her mouth and writes the name on the sand. After knowing all the truth, Titus is extremely enraged. Lucius also gets support of Goths and he plans to attack Rome. During the same time, Thamora gives birth to an illegitimate child by Aaron secretly, and in order to save his life, the life of the child, against the wrath of Saturninus, Aaron flees away with the child. He is captured by Lucius, who threatens him to kill the child if he doesn't reveal all the truth to him. Aaron tells him how he and Thamora planned the revenge against Titus and all the cruelties they did against Lavinia. Titus starts acting as a madman, and Thamora is convinced that she is about to succeed in her revenge. But she fears of Lucius attacking Rome, so she and her two sons, Chiron and Demetrius, disguise as the spirit of revenge, rape, and murder, and meet Titus. She tells Titus that he will succeed in taking revenge against his enemies if he convinces Lucius not to attack Rome. Titus agrees, and Thamora tells him to arrange for a feast for the emperor of Rome. Before she leaves, Titus insists that the spirit of rape and murder should remain with him. After she leaves, he captures Chiron and Demetrius, who are disguised as spirit of rape and murder, and beheads them and collects all their blood with the help of Lavinia. He then powders their bones and bake it to make a pie. Next day, Saturninus and Thamora arrive and he presents that pie to Thamora. Then he asks Saturninus whether a father should kill her daughter who has been raped and lost all her hope for independent and respectful life. Saturninus says yes, and Titus soon kills Lavinia with his dagger. He then reveals how Lavinia was raped by Tamora's sons and how they cut her tongue and both hands, making her a live corpse. Then Saturninus demands where are Demetrius and Chiron. Titus reveals that he has killed them and Tamora is eating the pie made of their blood and bone crush. Then Titus kills Lavinia and Saturninus in return kills Titus. But soon Lucius returns back and kills Saturninus. At the end, Lucius is declared the new emperor of Rome. He orders Titus and Lavinia to be buried in their family tomb and Saturninus to get state burial. However, he orders Tamora's dead body to be thrown in wild to be eaten by wild animals and Aaron to be buried chest deep in ground alive to die through hunger and thirst. As we can see, this play had extreme graphic violent scenes, and while it was very popular during the Elizabethan and Jacobean era, it was discouraged and repudiated during the later years. It was ridiculed by authors of Victorian era. T.S. Eliot, Samuel Johnson, and many others criticized this play for its graphic cruelty. However, it gained supporters too with time. In recent times, the play again gained life and some movies were made based on Titus Andronicus. In 1999, a Hollywood movie titled Titus was released, whose director was Julie Taymor. Anthony Hopkins played the part of Titus, while Jessica Lange played the role of Tamora. Laura Fraser played the role of Lavinia. In 2017, an Indian movie, The Hunger, was released, which was directed by Bornilath Chatterjee, and it was based on Titus Andronicus. This adaptation was set in modern New Delhi. The actors were Nasiruddin Shah, Tiska Chopra, and Sayani Gupta. Also, in the sixth season of Game of Thrones, Arya Stark kills Lord Welder Frey's sons and make a pie of them, which she serves to Welder Frey to eat as a revenge for his treachery against her family and how he killed her mother Catelyn and brother Robb Stark. After producing this extreme Senecan tragedy, Shakespeare wrote a couple of historic plays, Richard III, All Parts, and Edward III. Richard III could be considered as another Shakespearean tragedies. Richard III was performed in 1593 and Edward III was performed in 1596. Edward III was not included in the first folio because it was believed that this play was the reason that angered George Nicholson, who was Queen Elizabeth's agent in Edinburgh. The reason for his anger was the way in which Scottish people were ridiculed in this play, Edward III. Meanwhile, Shakespeare produced another comedy titled Comedy of Errors. It was performed in the year 1594 for the first time. The play is based on a slapstick comedy involving mistaken identity. Comedy of Errors is Shakespeare's shortest play and it is the most farcical comedy of Shakespeare, full of puns and wordplays. Shakespeare wrote only two such plays in which he maintained the unity of time along with the unity of action. That is, the play depicts such events that are completed within 24 hours in a sequence. The other such play was The Tempest. The drama tells the story of a Greek city, Iphias, where two identical twins get separated at birth. Antipholus of Syracuse arrives to Ephesus along with his male servant Romeo of Syracuse. In Ephesus, they encounter their identical twins, Antipholus of Ephesus and Romeo of Ephesus. When the two from Syracuse meet friends and family members of the two from Ephesus, strange, hilarious, and difficult situations arise. In India, Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar wrote a Bengali novel, Bhranti Bilash, which was an adaptation of Comedy of Errors. In 1988, a Hollywood movie was released which was based on the same plot, though female twins were depicted instead of male twins. In India, movies like Do Duni Char, in which Kishore Kumar was the main lead actor, and Angoor, in which Sanjeev Kumar acted, were produced which were based on Bhranti Vilas and hence on comedy of errors. So this is it for this section of our discussion of Shakespearean's works. We will continue to discuss other works of the Bard in the upcoming videos. Keep in touch with the discourse and the history of English literature. Thanks.